This is a steel wrench presented by Group T4. The material chosen to create the steel wrench was a low alloy steel 5150, and the manufacturing process for it begins with a long steel bar that gets cut down to size. That bar is then heated and forged into a rough wrench shape. The excess material of the wrench is then cut off and is allowed to cool. Finally, the wrenches are heat treated, quenched, and polished in order to get it prepared for shipping. The material was selected because since it's a steel wrench, it would be beneficial for it to not corrode, so chromium must be present inside the composition. So a 4, 5, 8, or 9 series steel would have to be chosen. The carbon must be present in the composition at a relatively high content, so between 0.40 to 0.60%. Other properties include having the proper strength, ductility, mass, cost, and other requirements and constraints which will be discussed further on in this video. The main purpose of a wrench is to lock around a nut or a bolt and provide a lever arm for force to be applied, which then causes torque, allowing the nut or bolt to be turned. The design for this wrench was created with a T24 size nut in mind. The distance between the jaws would have to be 36 millimeters in order to account for the nut. The length of the wrench would have to be 18 inches or 45.72 centimeters. This was determined by looking through a tool size catalog for wrenches. The thickness of the wrench is more of a free variable, with the minimum size being 19 millimeters. By reducing the thickness, cost and mass of the wrench can be reduced.
So first, we have to do some pre-analysis before we can actually discuss what material we want to make. So first, we have to talk about the functional requirements of the steel wrench that we're going to be constructing. So the first thing, we want to assume that it's a one-sided wrench. So the jaws are only on one side to tighten or screw the bolt in, and also to loosen the bolt as well. So first, it must withstand a maximum force of 200 newtons applied by the user without failing. This 200 newtons was discovered through research that the average human could output a force of 100 newtons. So to be on the safe side and account for the worst case scenario, we decided that 200 newtons is a suitable amount to work with. Additionally, it must not plastically deform, as if it was plastic deformed, it would hinder the performance of the steel wrench and render it useless as opposed to the other steel wrenches that are available right now. Additionally, it should not deflect more than 0.001 meters at equilibrium, and this equilibrium is when the wrench is being used to tighten the bolt at a max force. And obviously, you cannot stop it from deflecting, so keeping this at a minimum of 0.001 will make sure that the performance isn't hindered too much that it would render. So as seen from this diagram here, the contact point between the nut and the wrench, there are some red shaded areas which represent the areas of most stress that's applied on the wrench. So by focusing on these areas here, it can account for the whole wrench. It counts the fact that the whole length of the wrench has to be 0.4572 meters long, or 18 inches. This is decided from the fact that since we are applying a 200 newton force on the wrench, by making it 18 inches long, or 0.4572 meters long, it makes it easier for the user to tighten or screw the bolt that's being on the wrench. Also, that means that the length of the effective section that we're focusing on, which is the red shaded area, has to be 0.018 meters. And this was discovered from the fact that since we are applying a 36 millimeter bolt, that this will have a radius of 18 millimeters, which is approximately 0.018 meters, and that's what we're going to be assigning the length as. Additionally, the width of the effective section would be 0.03 meters, and this is purely taking the fact that since the whole length of the wrench is 18 inches long, that means that area will be 3 millimeters, which is approximately 0.03 meters. Also, the maximum mass of the wrench has to be 2 kilograms, and this is purely from the fact that nobody wants a heavy wrench to work with. So by keeping it at a maximum of this, it would make sure that the wrench would be affordable and easy to use. So from this diagram, it can be seen that the whole length of the wrench is 0.4572 meters long, and this area is 0.03 meters long, and this area is 0.018 meters long, which is the length here, which is represented by the variable L, and here is 0.03 meters, which is represented by the variable E. So now we have to discuss that the objective of the whole wrench is to obviously minimize the mass, right? By minimizing the mass to make sure that the wrench can be easy to use, because nobody wants to use a heavy wrench. So because of that, we're going to use the thickness as a free variable. As by allowing that to be a free variable, it allows us one more degree of freedom to work with. And because of that, it allows us to get a minimized mass. And also another free variable is the choice of material within the selection of steels. So after going through all the three analysis requirements, we're able to narrow it down and use some MPIs to come up with three different alloys using the CES software. So the first MPI that we created was able to relate yield strength with our density, and we wanted to maximize the yield strength, so anything above this line generated here would be acceptable. And the teal area is basically where the steel is. So now the next MPI we got was comparing Young's modulus to density, and obviously to maximize this Young's modulus, we create another line which is able to narrow down the list of materials as well. And anything above this line was deemed accepted and able to minimize the mass, which is our basic objective. So now, because of all the selections that we got, we're able to narrow it down even further by understanding that the high carbon content in steel is able to improve the strength, increase the hardness, and provide good wear resistance as well. Also, it was kept in mind that the wrench has to be used in a high-strength industrial environment, and it was learned that because of this, a low alloy steel is desired for this. Also, it was understood that the chromium content should be available in all the low alloy steels because this prevents corrosion and provides resistance to oxidation. So after using the pre-requirements and the CES software and understanding which results were able to fit our criteria, the first result that we got was low alloy steel AISI 5150. And as seen from the diagrams, they're able to see that the cost is $1.02 per kilogram, while the elongation is 25%, and the corrosion is slightly susceptible, and the hardness is 285 Vickers. The next one that we were able to narrow down to was low alloy steel AISI 8650. And compared to the previous one, cost of $1.14 per kilogram, elongation of 17%, being slightly susceptible, and a hardness of 335 Vickers. And the last result that we got that matches our criteria was low alloy steel AISI 4150. And as opposed to the previous two results, this had a cost of $1.07 per kilogram, elongation of 14%, corrosion resistance being highly susceptible, and a hardness of 3. So by looking at all these three, it is easy to find out that AISI 5150 is the cheapest compared to the rest. And obviously this is something we have to take into account because wrenches are going to be mass produced to be used in the industry. And the cheaper it is, the more profit that will come out for the producer. Also, important note that AISI 5150 also had the highest elongation as opposed to the two. And because we were able to narrow it down to the fact that these three were all able to meet the criteria, 5150 was able to be more ductile because of the higher elongation, meaning that it will resist permanent deformation, which is what the designer wants to be used in the long run. Also, through research, it was able to be discovered that AISI 5150 didn't have manganese and molybdenum in its composition, meaning that it's a lot easier to manufacture as opposed to AISI 8650 and 4150. As a result, we were able to conclude that low alloy steel AISI 5150 is the most desired steel to be used.
Due to the reason that low alloy steel can be applied to high strength structural and machine parts, and also cranium have really high corrosion resistance, and we find out for the steel milling system that 51 gonna redesign the first two digits for the steel. Therefore, we can start to discuss how we're gonna specifically produce and manufacture by using this material and how we're going to control the material property by applying some heat treatment process to control its mechanical properties. Here, I find out the chronic melting temperature is going to be 1900 degrees Celsius. The boiling temperature is going to be 2600 degrees Celsius. And for iron, the melting temperature is going to be 1500 degrees Celsius. And boiling temperature is going to be 2800 degrees Celsius. Therefore, as long as the melting temperature is below the lowest boiling temperature for both, the liquid state for the material will be stable enough for us to manufacture anything we want. And in order to completely melt both metal at the same time, because we're essentially producing the alloy of these two together, so we need to make sure we completely melt those two metals at the same time. So we need to at least, melting temperature will be at least 1900 degrees Celsius. I'm gonna talk about more detail about how we specifically do with the temperature and the time in order to control the steel properties. So therefore, the pre-request is for we need to have 0.5% carbon to in order to able to use this diagram, this TTT diagram. As you can see, the alloy we're choosing is 5150. So the 50 represents the carbon percentage. So if we divide 50 by 100, they will give you 0.5 as a percentage here. So we can apply this diagram to our heat treatment process. Because obviously, if we add in some additional element, like chromium or the other metals into the material, into the steel, it will affect the TTT diagram in a certain degree. But since the percentage of chromium is relatively low, therefore the TTT diagram should perform very similarly if we have the chromium. So before we start to control the percentage of the composition in the low alloy steel, we want to make sure there is 100% austenite, because above this temperature around here, we will 100 sure there is 100% austenite, so that we can certainly know we didn't create any other composition like perlite or bainite before we start to quench it. Therefore, we decide to hold the material, hold the alloy steel at around 850 degrees for 4 hours to make sure there's 100% austenite. Then we're gonna quench it to 680 degrees for around 100 seconds. So we carefully draw the line here to make sure there's 15%. The reason why we want a perlite is because perlite itself is more ductile and gonna give a higher fracture toughness than bainite. Therefore, the reason why we want ductility is because where we have continuous uses of the wrench, we want it to have certain ability to absorb some impact instead of being brittle and hard, so to have some permanent or plastic deformation on the wrench itself. So we wanna give some ductility to the wrench, so it has some elastic deflection, but it won't affect the whole shape. So therefore, we decide to have a small percentage of perlite in the whole structure. Then after that, we're gonna cool the material from 680 degrees to 420 degrees for around 1,000 seconds to have the rest of the low alloy steel to be 100% bainite. So it's roughly gonna be around 85% bainite in our whole structure. Well, bainite has higher hardness and can absorb, can withstand more stress than perlite. Because the reason why we want to be, we want to have high hardness is because for our ranch design, we essentially the main purpose is to make sure our ranch can withstand a very high stress. Therefore, we need the ranch itself to be strong. So we need some strong composition like bainite to take over the majority composition. And also the reason why perlite is weaker, have more ductility or lower hardness than bainite is because you can see this trend from here. So the temperature, the lower the temperature you go, the higher the hardness is gonna be. So based on the diagram, we can see the line I'm drawing here at 420 degrees for 1,000 seconds. We'll intersect here. So we know it passes the red line here, which is 100% bainite. So after making 15% perlite, the rest 85% of the low alloy steel will have 100% bainite because it passes this red line. After that, we will cool it to the room temperature. So in summary, we will have 15% perlite and 85% bainite. So from the above heat treatment, well, because we have more bainite than perlite, we will have essentially higher hardness, and we also giving some degree of ductility. The reason why we don't want much inside is because it's too brittle, and we're afraid that's going to have some permanent damage. So we were afraid the ranch gonna have gonna be easily exposed to some permanent or plastic damage, deflect. Therefore, by going through all the design process from the beginning to the end, well, we're able to design a suitable method for the industrial design of our ranch.